right? So the reason I wanted to do these talks with Kyle is this pandemic has changed a lot of how we moved and what we did in our days. And when you go back and look at, you know, let's say 2 years ago, you had basketball camps, you had recess, you had gym classes. You probably moved 40 to 50% of the day. And then all of a sudden, this pandemic hit and everybody stopped. Your gym classes were on a computer. Your exercise classes were on a computer. And then all of a sudden, during the real critical years of your growth, and Coach Kyle even said, pointed out a few of you that grew 4, 5, 6, 7 inches. But the interesting thing in this pandemic is you grew while you were sitting. You grew while you weren't developing. So what's really, really important in a talk like this is to kind of reset. So if you guys were to pull up a picture from January of 2020 of yourself and pulled up a picture on your phone of August 2021, it'd be very interesting to see how you changed. Some people got taller, which is a different body. Some people got thicker and wider, a different body. So I had one athlete who was a wide receiver for football. We had actually to change him. We had to change him and put him on the line. So he went from this little small thing to this huge monster in 13 months. And we had to adjust, because his injuries trying to play that wide receiver, he was too big and got too small. And that's just the way he grew. So all those details matter. And what we're trying to tell coaches now and parents is you have to look back at this athlete as a brand new human being. So not what they used to be. Because normally, as a coach or as a therapist or as a strength and conditioning coach, you would be developing. So your coaches for JAM or whoever it is, whether it's a high school or an elementary school, they would see you every day or every other day, and they can make adjustments for those growths. Your parents would know how many shoe sizes you changed. Your parents would know, oh, I got to buy them another pair of pants because they grew out of it. People would have those details going through, but those details were lost in the shuffle. You couldn't go buy a pair of shoes, so you ordered them online, not knowing any idea what size shoe you were, and whether the shoe was going to work or fit or not. Same with clothes. You couldn't, for whatever reason, they were non-essential, so you couldn't walk into a store and try a pair of pants on. So all those things that we wouldn't put details in and we wouldn't put a lot of emphasis on, all of a sudden got lost in the shuffle, and now all of a sudden you guys are back at sport going full swing. Now those details matter, right? So how many people grew at least one shoe size?
We had a couple that came in on Monday and they couldn't wear them Tuesday.
Exactly.
Tuesday to Wednesday.
Right? So that tells us that your bodies are different. So physiologically, and some of this stuff might be, you know, more than what you guys need to know, but you would grow strength while you're growing. You would grow flexibility if you needed it while you were growing. But what you've done over the pandemic is sat like this. And probably like this, right? Neck down. So all the muscles in the back of your chain have all now been lengthened, and everything in the front have now been shortened. And now you guys are in a sport where you have to lengthen that and have some control. So when you guys grow, the bones grow first. The muscles and the tendons and the connective tissue take a little bit of time to catch up. That's what jumper's knee is. That's what the patellofemoral stuff is. That's what all the aches and pains are. So, but traditionally, even though you've got some aches and pains and you're growing, you'd still be running, you would still be jumping, right? So all those things, those fundamentals of sport would still be occurring, but they haven't been. So now we've created an imbalance, we've created shortening of muscles that should be longer, we created length in muscles that aren't meant to be lengthened. So our bodies aren't the same as they used to be. So they'll come back, they'll adapt, but it's been a long haul and everybody's changed. Now you add 6 inches, you add 2 inches onto your feet. So you guys might even find the first day you showed up, you didn't move well. Heart might be pumping harder, lungs might be hurting a little bit. Those all come with the growth spurts too, right? So all those things that, again, that we would kind of slowly adapt, you guys are getting hit in this week. But they'll adapt. So just know that your warm-ups, all those times where the coach is trying to change your body and trying to put it in proper movement patterns, incredibly important. So normally, if there was a flight of stairs over there, I wouldn't have to walk like this. My brain would interpret the flight of stairs and the height of each rise. So by the time I got to the stairs, I am now looking up to the top. I don't have to look down at my feet for every stair. In these cases, what you guys have to do now, until your brain knows where your feet are and where your feet find out where the floor is and the length of all the muscles and the length of all the bones, that's what we call proprioceptive awareness, that needs to be retrained. So you can't rely on old movement patterns. You can't rely that your brain's gonna know where your feet are as you're going down the court. You're gonna find that every once in a while you're gonna do this. So all those movement retraining patterns that Coach Kyle's doing with you is incredibly important. The warm-ups are incredibly important. The real crappy stuff that you don't wanna do because you wanna be dribbling basketball, those end up being the most important pieces now. Just for a short time. Just until your brain recognizes the changes in your body, the changes in your body are re-recognized to a wall and to a floor. Because every time you grow, you lose a little bit of that memory. So you probably heard of muscle memory. That is true, except in a case like this. So what we say is like riding a bike, I'm gonna remember how to do it. True, but when you add the growth phase in the fact that you've had a year, maybe a little bit more off of basketball, you can't rely on that muscle memory anymore because that muscle physiologically has changed too much. So when you're our age and say, yeah, it's like riding a bike, that's kind of true. But in your age, there's so many things that are adapting between hormones and all these other things, there is no muscle memory for you yet. So every time you pick up the ball over this week and, you know, the weeks leading up to the school year, you're almost retraining your body. You're training the touch of your hands. You're training your feet. All those things are really, really important. So the big thing here, don't get down on yourself. If you feel clumsy, if you feel out of whack, if you're feeling like you're not breathing well, you're not moving well, your back is sore, those are all temporary. And they're all 100% expected. Every kid is doing this.
So we talked a lot about today and the last few minutes, looking at our balls and dribbling. Eventually our brain will connect what this feels like for my hand to be here, not here. And I will never have to look again, okay? But it's a slow process. So she's saying do that with your footwork as well. Eventually you'll know what this feels like instead of that, okay? It's a great, great point.
Okay, so all that proprioceptive awareness comes back. Because just remember, think of being a year off school and sitting down for a math test. Not gonna go so well, is it? Right? So all those things are happening in your brain. Your hormones are different. You know, your hair is different, your feet are different, all those things change, but they're going to come back. It's just the camps that you're heading into this summer aren't going to be able to just be skill development. You're going to find that your coaches are going to pull you back a little bit because some of it's going to be real basic things. And it's, you know, not as fun as they are. They're really, really important to keep you safe. They're important to decrease your chance of injury. But more importantly, they're going to make you fundamentally a better basketball player. Because if you skip those pieces, you're not going to get very far because you're always going to be injured or you're always going to be disoriented or uncoordinated, right? Because it's like, give me a basketball and that's what you guys are probably looking at like right now, right? So I have no coordination with basketball. I've never played in my life. But I can do a physiological profile, right? I can take a human and I can tell them exactly what they're going to injure themselves as that person. So if I took you right now, I could tell you without 100% certainty what you would injure if you didn't do it. So those profiles I could do, but it's if I saw you in January of 2020 and didn't see you now, my physiological profile would be wrong, right? So as parents, as athletes, because you guys hold a lot of onus here, this responsibility is on you. Coaches are developing you, but if you don't tell them something's bothering you, if you don't tell them you don't feel right or whatever the case may be, they can't change that, right? All these things right now, unfortunately, can lead to injury. You can't rely on age, you can't rely on athleticism, you can't rely on fitness or genetics or any rest of it, because nobody has sat this long in a chair for school and sport and gym class and recess and all the rest of it. Okay, so you're gonna feel tightness in muscles you shouldn't be tight. You're gonna feel important. Those things are just, they're all gonna come. But we just need to know about it. Because he's got a lot of tools up his sleeve. He's got a lot of tips. So, and whatever they can't do, they'll call me to do. Okay, but it's not, don't think of it as a weakness. Don't think of it as, oh, you know what, a year ago I wouldn't have had a knot on my shoulder. It would never have happened before. Everybody is saying something like that.
So when the five come in, they usually like the treatment, don't they?
Yes.
The treatment,
yes.
In therapy, it's usually pretty darn good after. So I've never personally met someone that comes in not looking forward to treatment. Unless there's like a very specific, there's been some things I've had to do that were not pleasurable, but once it was done, relief, like she had to put a shoulder in for me, my shoulder was out of place for a few days, instant relief. That I wasn't looking forward to, I knew that would feel good. But like massage and working on sore tissues, feels pretty good actually. Something to do in self-care.
Okay, so the other things that you guys can obviously influence is your hydration. Another big one is sleep. So there's a lot of research out there on sleep right now, and it's been there for a long time, but they're just now really starting to emphasize it. You know, being on your iPads or iPhones till 11 o'clock at night, that will eventually come back to haunt you. You need to sleep, you need to take 10 to 15 minutes to decompress and fall into a really good sleep. If you can get really good sleep habits, it'll decrease your chance of getting injury substantially. Okay, so those phones and that communication with your friends and that outside world really should end about an hour after dinner time. Then you need to be in the moment. If there's some self-care you need to do, massaging feet, you know what I mean? All those things, those should happen in the evening. Icing the knee, all those things. You just let that phone go, tell your friends, you'll see, you'll talk to them in the morning, and get rid of those iPhones. And there's whatever phones are out there, Samsung, whatever they are, but get rid of your phones. And I'm sure your parents have all said that, so, but it's really, really important. There's technology creates an inflammatory response in our body, and that inflammatory response messes up with a whole other thing. We don't always obviously know what's a lot about it, but your age group in particular, like the younger ones 2 weeks ago, there was no point in me talking about it there because they were too young, but you guys are the right ones to not get addicted to that technology and know when to turn it on and when to turn it off and look after yourselves. Because you guys, a lot of you, I have no doubt, are going to head to university basketball and big, wonderful things. And you just don't want to be stuck and attached to those phones. Okay? You know, the hydration, make sure you're drinking 2 to 3 liters a day, sip it. If you're chugging it, it counts. It just doesn't count as much as sipping does. Okay? Make sure you're getting your calories in. Especially my girls, unfortunately. We look at ourselves with this distorted mirror all the time and understand that you're expending a ton of energy here. If you don't put the energy back in, you will injure the muscles. So the way that our energy systems work is we'll use the energy we have from our food first, right? So let's say our bagel and peanut butter. Then everybody thinks that we go to our fat sources, and we don't, we go to our muscle first. So the energy is derived by the muscle before it ever hits our fat cells. So anybody thinking that they're going to skip a meal or do anything like that, you're just harming yourself because you're actually not going to be burning the fat till long after that anyway. So make sure that you're putting the food in you. Don't worry about all those other things that are out there, fasting. Exercise, unfortunately, fitness, and the diet world all comes in fats. They come and then they go. And at the end of the day, you need fuel. Food is your fuel source. It's the easiest thing to control. So make sure that you're eating enough calories. If you don't know, there's a ton of apps out there. You just basically it'll ask you a bunch of information. You put it in. It has every single possible meal out there. You put it in, it'll tell you how many calories, and you'll have some idea of whether you're putting enough in.
I'll send a link out today in an email for a free one.
Perfect. Because we don't really know. Like, I did it for 2 weeks, and I'm busy, and I can say, because I was to blame, I only brought in 1,200 calories. And I run once a day, and I work out once a day, and I'm on my feet all day. I was like, holy smokes, I'm way low. But I didn't know it, because it seems like I've got food in my hand anytime I can have it, but it was nowhere near the calories I needed to put in my day. So if I don't do that, especially as we age, I'm going to start losing my muscle mass. You guys don't want to do it because a loss of muscle means an increase in injury. Okay? The other thing is the difference between absorption and digestion. So when we drink, right? So let's say, for example, a smoothie in the morning. That absorbs in 90 minutes. So that energy is available to you in 90 minutes. If you would eat white pasta, that energy is available for you in about 4 hours. If you eat whole wheat, so let's say whole wheat, buy a piece of bread with toast, that's not available for 12 hours. So when you're looking at game day, the game day meal used to be pasta or chicken and pasta and salad. And it's not wrong, but we don't do game day meals anymore because that food was never available for the actual game. So if you're going to play, let's say at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you're not gonna wanna have a liquid breakfast because you might have to have a liquid lunch. So you wanna make sure that wherever you've got 4 solid hours to digest, you want your solid food in that time frame. And the closer you get to game time, you wanna liquefy it.
How long does it take for like eggs?
Protein's a little tougher. You're probably about 6 hours. Yeah, yeah. Right, so you want to look at that. So I know everybody's against white pastas, and if you're not gluten or celiac or anything else, that still should be part of your pregame. 4 hours before though, not two. Okay, so if there's any energy pieces, or if you're just trying to figure out what to eat, those are things you want to think about. You know, the smoothies and stuff came in, again, as a fad. They've stuck around a little bit, but I always tell my kids, you can eat a solid meal, eat the meal, don't drink it. Because there's a lot of sugar usually in that drink. And if you were to take everything, line up everything that you would have put in that shake, it's usually a lot more than what you would have eaten. Right? So a lot of people will put pineapple and strawberries and bananas and all this stuff, and you've just, yeah, you know, had 5 different fruits and all the sugar that goes with it. Natural sugar, but sugar nonetheless. Okay, so you're still better off when you can eat, but if you can't, liquefy. Protein shake if you're allowed, or a smoothie works just fine. It will give you enough energy. If you get it in 90 minutes, it lasts about 2 hours. So it will get you through a basketball game. Okay, the other thing I want to touch on are a little bit of supplements and going back to the, to the drinks and stuff. Gatorade was designed by a scientist at Florida State University. And this was a trainer for the men's football team, so the Florida State Gators, yeah, Gators, right? And this guy was trying to figure out how to get his football players who were outside for more than 90 minutes in extreme heat, how he could get them through the end of practice or through the end of the game. So he designed an electrolyte drink that has sodium, potassium, obviously sugar, water. And he designed this Gators aid. There was an S in there before. And it worked. And when he retired from Florida State University, the university gave him a patent. They said, we're never going to use this. Now that you're gone, you can take it. Well, really dumb idea on the state, on Florida. But so what happens though in the supplement diet world is that you can't make something medical. You have to make something fitness first. The way you can only, so if I was to design a machine for concussions, I have to initiate that as a fitness machine first before I can call it a medical machine. So what happened was the only way you could get Gatorade on the market was to change it slightly so that the average human could use it, which anytime anything's endorsed, it's your age group that falls for it, right? In every refrigerator, in any store, and gas station all over the world. Understand that an electrolyte drink, Gatorade, Powerade, or something you make yourself, is only effective once you've sweated for 90 minutes. If you just drink it because you like the flavor of the orange Gatorade, you are throwing off your metabolites. You're throwing off your sugar levels, your salt levels, all those levels that aren't already off, you are now increasing them. When you increase anything in the body, something else has to activate to balance it back out, which is going to be insulin. When you put sugar in your body, the pancreas releases insulin. When you insulin gets released, your energy, your metabolism drop. So I have taken across the entire OHL, this is probably about 10 years from now, we actually don't have Gatorade on our benches for the first and second year. It looks like we do because we have Gatorade bottles, but we have water. Water, water, and only water. So until you've sweated everything you could possibly sweat out, maybe just a bit before that, you should not be using an electrolyte drink. Okay? So just for those of you, because I can see confusion with your question. And that's not terrible, but also understand that the majority of the Gatorades have way too much food in them. So in a day, in a week like this where it's warm, you could do a third, and a third, right? That would be enough replenishment for you. You wouldn't need it. Your age, that bottle is also for a 240-pound adult male.
Bigger than me.
Bigger than him. So he could maybe get away with a full bottle in a sitting, but even that would have to be after running a half marathon. You guys don't need Gatorade. You need water.
That's what my mom tells me all the
time. Yeah, funny how that works. So, but at the end of your camp day, if you have a bottle, just drink a third of it, because that's all your body needs. Anytime you add or take away, your body has to do something to balance it. It's called homeostasis. So your body spends all day long trying to find balance. So the more things you recreationally throw off, the more that your body is taking energy from your arms and your legs, from your digestive system, from whatever else is going on, and now it's, you know, working something else. Okay, so really, really important, make sure your calories are high. The biggest thing when I talk at university level is I tell them to know what they're putting in their body and have a reason. So if you said, Kim, I went to Tim Hortons and I got a peach juice in the bottle, I would say, okay, well, tell me why you bought it. If you could tell me what's in it and you could tell me why you needed it, then that would be okay. But it also has 11 teaspoons of sugar in it. So you have to have a pretty good reason. So understand all those things, those big bottles, whether it's pop or iced tea or lemonade or peach drinks, they are way, way too much for you. A third of it at most. But sugar's an addiction, so these companies get away with getting the bottles bigger and bigger, and then you guys are the age group that unfortunately gets addicted to sugar.
So in my science class, I do a test with my kids in the first week. So they're always doing the Arizona's and the Monsters or something like that, right?
Yeah.
Tons of sugar. And I do this experiment where you set it on fire, it's pretty explosive. But
The size of it.
It's usually servings, so yeah. It's not just like this. 32 grams of sugar, so that is too much sugar. Even a can of pop, if you were to drink that, typically you would throw it up. But the companies are smart. They add a chemical that kind of overrides that, so you don't regurgitate. Because your bodies are smart. It's like, oh, too much sugar. I don't need it. But this chemical allows it to stay in, and you're absorbing all of that sugar. It's a dirty trip, okay?
And understand, if there's a lot of marketing behind it, I'd be looking into what it has. You know, I went to, that hockey where you're, it's kind of like a crashed ice.
Oh, yeah.
So I was the lead medical for the Worlds in Niagara Falls a few years ago. And Red Bull, I don't drink caffeine, I've never had a coffee in my life. So Red Bull was the sponsor. And I had no idea how much money Red Bull had until I was at an event put on by Red Bull.
Yeah, they like last year or the year before they sold the can for everybody in the world.
Yeah. And it was if I had ice tables that were all ice, and it was in Niagara Falls, a pretty expensive place. They had women from Russia, literally from Russia, they flew in with the fur coats and everything, handing out this Red Bull. So I took a step back and obviously kind of just doing that look around. So understand that in probably a little bit even before us, cigarettes and alcohol were the prime influencers, will say. You go to a baseball game, the guys are smoking. Now it's energy drinks. So it's a different harmful, right? You know, and it's going to only a matter of time before those guys are no longer allowed to advertise to you guys. But at no time in your age group do you need caffeine. You just need to sleep more, you need to eat more, or you need to drink more. But you don't need any type of supplement. Really, at your ages, most of you don't need protein, most of you don't need collagen, most of you don't need branched chain amino acids. You have enough stores in your little bodies, you can handle this stuff. And if you don't, then you know your parents can make that call. But if you're eating the way you're supposed to be eating, you guys don't need to supplement. You need to eat real foods. So don't go down that rabbit hole of supplements and all those cool factors, because at some point, it's gonna stop working. At some point, you're gonna need more and more and more. Right? So it's like a gel. When a runner takes a gel, which is just sugar, in a run, every 12 minutes after that, they have to put another one in. So at some point, no matter what it is, whether it's a caffeine, an energy drink, or a sugar, you're gonna crash. And you're gonna have to keep putting it in because you're just gonna feel crummier and crummier. You're better off to make tweaks in your daily schedule than to add anything in to make life easier. Because there's always an outcome and it's gonna be negative at some point. Okay? Any questions?
How do you get out of a big knot?
Come sit here and I'll do it for you while I'm answering yours.
Yeah, actually, this might be a little difficult for these guys because this is for me. I see this chance to stay where I'm practicing now. I'm always working out or going to pick up games and this.
Yep.
I get one when I'm essentially just falling to bed. I know the difference between healthy and unhealthy.
Yep.
But I can end up eating like this amount of broccoli, like several different chicken breasts, and I never feel like, I never feel fulfilled, like I'm still hungry. Is there a reason for that? Or no? Like, if I'm providing more calories,
So there's different levels of metabolism, right? So the long lean people, you need to eat consistently. So what the body's trying to do is trying to fill that void all in one meal. Now that fullness signal comes about 20 to 30 minutes after. So the only way you'd be able to do that is you have to walk away, and in 30 minutes, if you are still truly hungry, you can eat again. Because your body type might just burn calories really, really fast. But the problem is if you're not putting those little meals in throughout the day, if your metabolism is that fast, you're burning muscle because it's finding it somewhere, right? The body's job is to, it has a plan A, B, C, and D. So if it can't do A because you haven't eaten, it's gone down the chain and it's finding it from somewhere. And chances are by the end of the day, it's gone into your fat zone, which would be fine if you had any. Right? But if you don't, then it goes right back to the muscle.
Fair enough. Right? He was eating like 5,500 calories he was burning. When he measured. That's a lot, right?
That's a lot. Yeah. So, but you need to eat maybe 1,000 calories every 3 to 4 hours. Right? Just so you're okay now, but what's going to happen when you turn 40 is that's going to flip. You're either going to start to gain weight because you've created a pattern in your body to eat all this food in one sitting. Your metabolism levels off, and it will, then you created a pattern that's going to be really, really destructive. So you're better off to go to the small meals. I'm not a big fan, so again, 6 small meals a day came as a fad. There's nothing wrong with 3 meals. People don't have to find those, you know, I'm not a snacker, I don't put 2 snacks in my day, you know what I mean? But it all depends on what you're doing. Everybody's individual. Right? What you're doing, what you can stomach in the morning. Some people can eat breakfast. That's where a liquid breakfast would be better than nothing. But understand that when you sleep, your body goes into a starvation mode. Now, it's slowed down because you're sleeping. But the other thing, it's looking for food in the morning, and it's looking for water. So, you know, when they say breakfast is an important meal, it is, you know, depending on how you feel in the morning. But it would be a better time to put food in for sure, even if it's just in small quantities.
I mentioned yesterday that to try and win that hydration battle early in the morning for them. So 16 ounces, give it 20 minutes, try and get another in.
Yep.
And just, you'll notice a difference when the hydration is on point, and you really notice it when it's not. Anyone have any headaches in the back of their head or across their forehead? To me, that's how I get that when I start to feel dehydrated. And I'll talk and I can feel this pain.
Yeah. So if you get a headache, instead of reaching for the Tylenol or the Advil, drink a one of those full athletic bottles of water and wait 20 minutes and see if it goes away. So that, you know, we don't run to the medicine because it could very well be. And the Tylenol might help for the moment, but at the end of the day, you're still dehydrated, right? And that's one thing you don't want to stay in. You want to be hydrated. So the other thing too is when you pee throughout the day, make sure it's a very light pale color. And that's one way you can tell that you're on point for hydration. So with my OHL team, for the Wolves, in the bathroom, I have a calendar on the wall. And every hockey player is in there. And this might sound gross, but it's necessary. When they pee, they have to tell me the color. So there's a black, there's literally a pen in there, and they got to check off. So that I know if anybody going into a game scenario is dehydrated or not. So it gives me time to get them out of that, basically that spin, right? Because it's really hard, because I can't get them to chug water, it doesn't work. If you chug water, it goes right through the bladder and out, right? So you have to sip it, and sometimes you run out of time to do that.
Are you like the main person for keeping the walls healthy?
I am. I've been for a very long time. Are you a hockey kid?
No.
So Kim is an athletic therapist. It's slightly different than a physiotherapist. Some of you might tune in for the physio. In fact, your mom is one, right? She doesn't. She knows Kim actually.
Yeah.
So to me, if I were to go back and redo my education, I love teaching. Don't get me wrong. I absolutely love it. But working with athletes would also be my choice and something that I've discovered I love from coaching as I became a teacher. So like what? How did you get it? What did you do?
So I did an undergrad in exercise science, which I think now is like a kinesiology, yeah. Right? So I became a kinesiologist first, and then I actually didn't know what I wanted to do. So I moved to Kitchener, and I worked one side. I worked in this really neat place where half of it was physiotherapy and half of it was athletic therapy. And the athletic therapy side, it was... the women's Olympic softball team was getting treatment there. And so I did my time with physio and I loved it, but it wasn't quite the energy that I crave in my personality. So, and then I went over to the athletic therapy side and it was loud and people were screaming and balls were bouncing in the corner and it was just, I'm like, huh. And some personalities would have found it very chaotic. But for the people in it getting treatment, it was very soothing and very familiar, and it was a really cool environment to heal people in because the therapist knew the names, they knew the sports, they knew the families, they knew. So there was an hour treatment, and it was kind of like a small community, almost like a small family. And that's when I was like, okay, that's what I'm doing. So then I went back to school for 3 more years, and when I was there, I did 7 years in osteopathy. I did a year in acupuncture, and I worked with the Leafs in 1999-2000. I worked in the CFL, and then I still work in the NHL and the OHL, and obviously the Sudbury Five. So, pretty cool job, actually.
Have you met any of the hockey players?
I just saw 3 of them yesterday, actually. Yeah, I know tons of them.
Who'd you see yesterday?
Can't tell you that. Like, tell you Nick and Marcus Foligno. I just can't tell you the other ones because they're.
So Tyson is the one that asked. He's at goalie. He's the one that he's only 12 years old.
So I've worked on Mike Smith, who's with Edmonton. Obviously, Connor McDavid comes through. The Foligno brothers, Tyler Bertuzzi. Holy smokes, I'm gonna age myself. Brian Savage, Mike Fisher, the Stahl brothers. Yeah, John Tavares. I worked with Leafs. So I was there when Ty Domi was there, Wendell Clark was there. That was my time. Yeah. Sorry, I'm aging myself, but yeah, that was a little while ago. And athletes are really, really, really cool humans. They're in tune with their bodies. Not that the rest of us aren't, but the rest of us aren't. There's a big difference between it being your job and it being your fun time. And there's a lot of science. So, you know, in this field, in my field, even though the program itself might not be as science-based, when you're doing a physiological profile or I've got a $9 million athlete in front of me, it's probably 90% science. So but the cool part is working with the groups of people. Sudbury has phenomenal practitioners, and then obviously going forward to pro teams and Olympic teams and stuff like that. There's just some really cool people out there that you get to work with. So any other questions about body parts?
So I know these two ladies on the end, and Mila is the one that is so flexible that the stretches aren't working. And Aurora is lower back pain,
okay.
but could be the front of the body. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
I will defer to the expert.
Okay. You're the flexible one? What's your family's initial last name?
Is it Ricky?
Look familiar to me. Your sister?
Yeah.
Okay. That's fine. Yes, you're a very common face. So stand up for me. Okay, so if you look at her feet, she definitely has more of an athletic foot than a dancing foot. She has a wide, like between the big toe and the baby toe, it's wide.
Yeah.
So she wouldn't do very well on those.
Okay.
No. Yeah, we're just kind of going over the flexibility thing,
yeah.
Right?
Because I thought you were a dancer or something, right? It's crazy.
So she's double jointed. So what happens in bodies like that is they either have looser connective tissue,
yeah.
Meaning that she has no end range.
Okay.
So the rest of us, when we do a stretch, there's that tug,
yeah.
Right, that tells our brain, okay, that's as far as we should. It's called a physiological range of motion. It just means she's warmed out. So those end feels she doesn't have.
So is that the culture tendon?
Yeah. So the problem though is she doesn't know her end ranges. Her brain can't interpret when to stop.
Yeah.
So you're right, she would be better foam rolling,
okay,
than stretching beyond. Like, do a normal stretch that seems like it should be. If you don't get any feel from it, then I would go for moving to be safe.
Does that make sense? I can elaborate to you.
Yeah.
Later on, which is going to let you explain a little more what she means by that.
Or do a dynamic warm up as opposed to static stretching with her.
Yeah.
Warm up with movement. As long as you're getting red and flushed and a little warm, you can guarantee that there's oxygen and blood going to those tissues and you're safe. That's your warm up. You don't need to stretch.
Yeah.
There's also some backlash in the stretching world too in terms of research, because they're now, you know, there's a lot of thought and belief that a static stretch could be harmful. So a lengthened muscle is a weaker muscle. So if you look at someone taller than even Kyle, did anybody see my coach Logan, 75? See how long and tall he was? I could probably out bench press him because I'm shorter and I'm thicker. So two completely different bodies. And what happens in my longer athletes is that you guys spend so many years on pull because of the growth, I probably stopped growing when I was 12 or 13, right? So I have more stability in my body than someone who grew well into their 20s. So if you stretch like a longer body stretches, they're either not gonna feel it or they can produce a weaker muscle. Now, somebody my size or your size that has more power behind them, we would benefit from stretching. We almost need it, right, in order to feel good, right? So for some body types, it won't work for another, it's really very beneficial. But again, it is kind of person dependent.
And I think we'll do a lower back issue.
You? I mean, why have you got it? It's probably QLs.
Okay. So is that kind of this actually here?
Yeah. So it's probably and hip flexors.
Yeah. I'm sure the hip flexors.
Yeah.
So
she's pretty well.
Yeah.
Oh, sure. Who feels that?
Right. Do you mind here, Roy? Okay.
So that guy.
Yeah.
So okay, is mom or dad doing massages? Because you could ask for one. You know, or you're welcome to come see me too.
It
takes me 30 minutes.
I'll see you on the email.
Yeah.
Her dad works at ballet, so they've got coverage, and then we're going to run this like this. That's what we're going to do.
Oh, yeah.
So
okay.
I don't have any memory yet, but I'll get you in touch with
me. So I just need to massage that a little bit, kiddo, and when you can get that, you can start to get flexor stretching now, and that will start to. Because you got to remember, you did this. So these guys are stronger. So the other thing to keep in mind is the muscles in front of you, so all these in front of you are power muscles. These muscles behind you are postural. So you didn't see Andre sprint backwards. He sprinted forwards, right? And in some physiologies, like a sprinter, they almost balance out in terms of type of twitch muscles they have, like fibers. Majority of us don't. We have power in front, postural in back, two completely different things. Which is why we hurt the back of our body, not the front of the body. But 9 times out of 10, the cause is coming from the front of the body. Okay? Mm-hmm. I need to shoot some.
Oh.
I need to see your feet. Your feet smell good.
Don't worry about it. If it was major, I
change everything. Otherwise, we'd be making $100 million on the catwalk modeling. We're not symmetrical. We're not meant to be symmetrical. Your sport isn't symmetrical, right? So you always run. So when I get dancers, and they, you know, they spend their time in this first, second, and third, and they have hip problems. The only way I can resolve the hip problems is to retrain them to go back in this line with the front of that plane where we're supposed to move through. They don't move through that plane. They're partly sagittal when they move. So I'm trying to correct something sometimes will decrease your function in your sport. So it's to understand the differences. Not at your age, but what you may have to do, though, that's serratus, the muscles that basically help you rotate. You may need to take a band, and you may, but when you do the band exercises, that's when you have to do both directions. It's just, it's multi, obviously multi-sport athletes, there's a bit of a problem, right? In the sense that you're, in here you're playing basketball, out there you're playing golf or whatever it is, right? They're not always easily crossed over. So sometimes it gets to a point in life where you have to choose, and other times you may just have to understand when you transition over, you may have some, let's say, muscle awareness, not necessarily injuries, but where you're aware of things kind of being sore or tight will come from a different sport. But I wouldn't worry about it yet.
I play hockey, soccer, basketball.
So you play lots? That's good. It's a good thing. Same day, same moment? No, so it just means that you're still, you know, young, but some people you'll find as you get older, it's hard to transition between. That's all. But do it. It's still better for you. It's still better for development.
So I have, like, feet issues on this specifically.
Yep.
I'm pretty sure it's called plantar.
Where is it? Where is it sore?
Like, in the back area.
Like back in here in the heel?
Yeah.
Not on the bottom of the foot?
No.
So it's not plantar fasciitis?
So I was just wondering if
it could be Achilles. It's probably, if you stand up, I could probably tell you.
It's like a very good spot. It's near the bottom, but not the bottom. Like it's right.
Yeah, it's probably a tendon attachment of the Achilles. Turn around, let me see your calves.
So what are you looking for in this area?
So. And this isn't any disrespect, but we're still kids, so there's still baby fat, right?
Yeah.
So what happens, so see how tight his calves are?
Yeah.
So it's definitely going to be some component of that.
And he's also got tight up into here as well. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So he would be a good one probably for Mike.
Okay.
Or definitely some sort of role. It's hard to do the lower body, like the back of the body, but you need to loosen those muscles up. Could even be a type of tight.
Hey, so it's fixable.
Oh, yeah.
Now you know you're in control of your body again. Yes, she's telling you what you need, right?
So you need, and stretching that might not work. So someone might have to go in and massage it as you. Because how many inches did you grow since last year?
5 to last year, 4 to 6 this year.
Yeah. So, right? So it's good, but remember I said the muscles sometimes take a year to catch up? You're in that year. So you gotta nurse the attachments of those tendons because they do start to pull.
Right.
So you have to do some foam rolling and you have to get your water up.
Okay.
Sometimes
when I run, like right here.
Yep.
I think it's like really bad.
Stand up. I'm just better looking.
Away from it, and eventually you'll literally feel
okay.
tight right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're tight. So you've got a muscle. It's hard to see, so that kind of muscle comes through.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's a thin muscle there. It's like literally the hardest muscle stretch in your body. So what would be good there to take this?
So that's probably
another thing. This is a bit sharp.
So the kneecap when you're in utero is forward.
Up and down that dimension. Does that make sense?
Sometimes they don't
work. Yeah, or exactly that. And you just, you don't even have to push right.
So get the ultrasound and then let me know. Okay? Get the ultrasound. That's probably what's called a plical injury. On the back of your legs? Yeah, so it's a lot of calves.
Tons, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. A lot of calves. So, I mean, it might have been there already, but again, coming back to this pandemic where you guys have been sitting, and I read a report, the average child, you guys, not, but let's say adolescent child, sat 86% more during the pandemic than any age group ever.
Oh, yeah.
86. So you would sit in class, but then you'd get up, you'd go to your little group, you'd get up, you'd go for recess, you'd ask, Miss, can I go to the bathroom? So, yeah, yes, you would sit, but you wouldn't sit as much as you were doing. And we had no sports, so what did you do? Game, right? Back on the iPad, watch a movie, read a book, even some of the good things, still seated. Some people took up knitting or bracelet making or whatever it was, but it was still seated, right? So it's that, remember I said everyone's going to, you've contracted this and stretched this. So now that you're hammering, a stretched muscle is a weak muscle. And now with the jumping and the running, that weak muscle, which should be functioning every day to keep you upright, but it wasn't, now is taking the load. So you could definitely handle most of that with like a warm bath. Get the warm bath and stretch it out, okay? As your hypermobile, you have too much movement in your joints. You may just need a little bit of a sleeve of brace to prevent that movement. That's what's happening. Yep, exactly. That's why it's hypermobility. So you would need to put a little sleeve on. If it was one-sided, then it probably could be an injury. But because it's happening, it's because you're too mobile. You have too much movement in your body.
And would she be able to use those sleeves like from sports check? They're not that long.
Yep. Make it simple, don't make it, yeah, put them on. You're still going to have some movement, but it's still better than having a rub. Because you don't, remember when I was telling Coach Kyle, you don't have the structure that limits range. Right? Some kids are born without it. My oldest daughter doesn't have it either. So what happens is that it's almost like when you get an email or a text and your phone buzzes, there's no feedback from that joint to tell you you're about to go further than it should. So you hammer that kneecap every time you run until it hurts. So we gotta try that control. It's doable, it's just a little tougher.
Okay.
But it's doable, okay?
Any other questions? Okay, so again, I will send on the email tonight, this will be uploaded as a YouTube link. Kim's contact information will be there. And I will encourage your parents to reach out if you guys have anything. Okay, so before Kim goes, her time is very valuable, and I'm so appreciative of what she's done for me and my family. So a bracelet, a mask, and the tea.
Yes, I'll wear it.
This is the best one. It's better than that one.
Okay.
This is the same
way. Okay.
And then we got this shirt here.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you, Kim. Thank you so much.
Thank you. guys, so yeah, any questions, reach out. You can come and get hold of me directly, so, you know, feel free. Knowledge is power, right? And as you guys are getting older, it falls further on you than it does on your coach or parents. Okay, so lots of water, good sleep, get off those phones, take care of yourself in the evening, and listen to what your body's telling you. Deal? Okay.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you.
All right. We've got about 30 minutes of shooting work. So we're going to just get you moving a little bit here. The shooting work is actually fairly low intensity today, but let's